So today we have around 10 people, and including the master student from irrigation department, right?
Yes.
Okay. The topic of training today is climate change impact on water management, climate smart irrigation. Today, I'm very proud to introduce Dr. Kedvara Sitichok from Irrigation Engineering Department. Dr. Kedvara, she graduated from Ottawa University in Canada and become the faculty member since 2016. And she's have a lot of project and a lot of academic papers related to the climate change. Today, I think the topic that about the climate change impact on water management is Dr. Kevara's expertise field, right? So, Dr. Kevara, are you ready to present today?
Yes, yes, of course, I'm ready. Okay.
So please, Dr. Kevara.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Shupan, for introducing me. Before I'm sharing the slide, if it's possible for the participants that if you can turn on the camera, it's going to be good that we can see each other and maybe we can discuss it. Okay. And let me share. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let me share the slide. Today, the topic is about the climate change impact on water management, and also it is about the climate smart irrigation. Before we are going to start, I'm not sure that anyone working in the climate change area or not. If it's so, maybe we can just like sharing information or just like the knowledge that maybe your country working about the climate change in another way, and also about migrantee in another way. So we can share just like information and knowledge together. For the climate change impact on water management and climate smart irrigation. If anyone want to ask question or want to discuss anything, you can interrupt me anytime that you want, okay? Or maybe you just like put the question or put the topic that you think that it is interest and you want to discuss in the chat box as well. So I can see it and then I can check it later. Let's start with the topic about today. When we look to the topic that is climate change, impact on water management, climate smart irrigation, so we can find the keyword that is the three keywords. It is about the climate change. It's about the impact of climate change, maybe on water resources, on agriculture, and also the topic that is about the climate smart irrigation. So we have the three keywords here for today. Actually, this is the topic that usually I teach my graduate students for the whole semester. So just like for 4 months, that is, I try to conclude it in the simple way, not going much to details, but I just want you to know about the source of the data, or how can you download data that you can work it, continue working it in this area, and also about how people in this just like water resources engineering field working about the climate change. And if you know something, you can also just like discuss with me as well. So maybe we can just like put to the project. So climate change, what we are going to talk that is about what is climate change. We need to know about that. When we need to know about the climate change, we need to know about the greenhouse effect and also about the global warming as well. And also about the greenhouse gas. About the greenhouse effect, we have the interesting topic tomorrow that is about reducing greenhouse gas emission from agricultural sector. So it's going to continue from this topic today. For the climate change, when people know about the climate change, it's not about just like tomorrow the weather is going to be just like the temperature is going to be rise, or tomorrow that is going to be just like hotter from today. This is not like that. Just like people try to make fun, sometimes try to make a joke of that. That when we talk about the climate change, we try to look to the long-term weather. It means that just like the long-term weather pattern that is trying to just like a bit change from the past, that is about the climate change. So if you familiar with this field, you can see that the ice that is in the Atlantic, is it polar, that is melting, is kind of that. So the climate change, we talk about the pattern. We talk about the temperature, we talk about the sea level rise, that is the pattern rain precipitation pattern that is changed. So it's just like a significant change in weather in a long period of time that is about the climate change. Before we are going to move, go further, let's try to define the word about the weather and climate, because some people think that that is the same about the weather and climate, but actually it is not. When we talk about the weather, we try to look in the short period, in the sum factor, just like temperature today, tomorrow, next week, or maybe next month. It's just like a weather. So we have the weather forecast, that is we try to forecast 7 days, just like 14 days, 3 months, that is kind of the weather. And how about the climate? In here, they put that climate, it should look through around 25 years. And most people like to use the data just like that, 30 years for the climate. So we try to look just like a longer period for the climate. And also how about the variation? For about the variation, weather is vary constantly. Today that is no rain, tomorrow that is rain, another day that is no rain again. But also about the climate, we don't look to the very constantly, but we can see that a bit changing. I will show you about the evidence to prove, and to most people use that to prove that we are facing about the climate change. About the area that is mostly climate, try to look to the just like a larger area, but now we try to make it just like a downscaling to the local area. But for the weather, that is simple, that weather in different area, different just like different provinces, is a different weather. When we talk about the study, we talk about the weather in meteorology, that is about the weather, that this is about the climate, we talk about the climatology. So this is the simple definition that is different from the weather and from the climate. And so when we talk about the climate change, we cannot avoid talking about the greenhouse effect. Why? Because of the climate change that is the main resulting from the greenhouse effects. So what the greenhouse effect? Greenhouse effect, it is just like the natural system that already have, just like even the human or the population growth that is going to be go faster, or is it going to be the same just like in the past 50 years ago, greenhouse effect still there. So greenhouse effect, that is about the solar radiation that reached the Earth atmosphere. And then just like some part of that, the heat that is keep in the atmosphere, and some part of that that is just like infrared radiation that is going back outside the atmosphere. So this figure that is quite show the difference between natural greenhouse effect and human enhanced greenhouse effect. As you can see, that is solar radiation from the sun come to the Earth. Some part of that that is re-radiate and heat back to outside the Earth. And some of that that is keep inside the Earth, just like from the atmosphere, keep the Earth warm. How the heat keep in the earth, in the atmosphere, because of the greenhouse gas. We have carbon dioxide, we have nitrogen oxide, we have methane that is keep it. So, but this is natural greenhouse effect already have. But when we talk about the human enhanced greenhouse effect, you can see the red part here. That is just like a larger, much more than the natural greenhouse effect. And you can see about the alphabet that is bigger from the carbon dioxide in this part. It means that we have carbon dioxide, we have methane, we have nitrate oxide, we have greenhouse gas that is more than the natural greenhouse effect that is in the natural one. So that's why when we have more greenhouse gas, it means that we have the capacity to keep the heat that is not going back outside of the earth, so less heat escape into the space. So that's why this is the difference between natural greenhouse effect and about the human enhanced greenhouse effect. That is the difference. So that's why when we talk about the greenhouse effect that is come from the human enhanced, it means that we are talking about the global warming. So we try to say that global warming caused by human activity when we talk about the global warming. So if we talk about the greenhouse effect in natural warming process, that is going to be just like in the natural thing. So people say that global warming that is come from the human activity, that is because of us that is caused the global warming that changed the natural greenhouse effect to the enhanced greenhouse effect by human activities. That's the part of the greenhouse effect and global warming. When we talk about the greenhouse gas, what we have for the greenhouse gas, we have the main one that is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide come from the transportation, come from the fossil fuel combustion, from the coal and crude oil. So that's why now we try to have just like we try to not use the fossil fuels, because of we are going to release more carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. So that's why we try to reduce. We also have the greenhouse gas. We also have the methane that is come from the agriculture, natural gas system come from the landfill from the methane. We have the nitrous oxide that is from the car, from the transportation, manufacturing, and also from the agriculture, soil management as well. This is the three main one of the greenhouse gas. And also, we also have the hydrofluorocarbon. We have the perfluorocarbon. We have the sulfur hexafluoride. That is just like not the main one, but it is strong to for keeping the heat inside the earth. So for the carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrate oxide, we have another word to call it that is called global warming potential. So what is it? What is the global warming potential? Global warming potential, that is the how the gas remain in the atmosphere and how that is strong to keep and absorb the energy of the heat inside the earth. That is the how long a gas remains in the atmosphere. That is the global warming potential. So what we have for global warming potential, we have just like fossil fuel, that is for one. In the global, we have around 73%. We also have methane that when compared it to the carbon dioxide, that is the 25 times compared to the carbon dioxide, it means that we have the main one that is carbon dioxide. And for another greenhouse gas, we try to compare how strong it is to the carbon dioxide. So methane that is 25 times from the carbon dioxide that is strong to absorb energy or absorb the heat, that is around 20% of the earth. We have nitrate oxide, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, and sulfur as well. So this is the one term that should know about the global warming potential. Okay. So when we talk about the climate change, most people need the factor or need the just like the thing to point out about the climate change. One index that people like to use and is about the carbon dioxide. What is this? Because of why it's easy. When we talk when we talk about the carbon dioxide, it means that we have the measure. People measure about the amount of the carbon dioxide from the past until now. So it means that we can compare about the amount of the carbon dioxide that from the past 50 years ago until now, how increase or how decrease of the carbon dioxide. So it's easy to make a statistic compared to historical climate. That is also easy as well because of we measure it from the past. But when we only talk about the carbon dioxide, it may make people confused that maybe only carbon dioxide that is make the greenhouse effect, but this is not because of there are more greenhouse gas from also from natural, from anthropogenic, is mean that from just like a human activity that is caused the greenhouse gas as well. Another thing that scientists like to use to point out about the climate change, that is temperature for sure, because I hope that you heard about it before about the temperature. The Earth's temperature is rising up in the average around 1.5 degrees Celsius or maybe almost 2 degrees Celsius. Because of temperature, that is the same thing about the carbon dioxide, that is it's easy to make statistics. So just like from the past as well, people, scientists already measure about the temperature of the Earth, just like average temperature of the Earth until now. So we can see it, that is how the different from the past. But also maybe it's made understand as well about the climate temperature, about the thing that we talked earlier, that is about the weather, or about the daily temperature. That is, this is the thing that most people a bit confused about the climate and about the weather. And also not only for temperature. Now, if you look to the paper or just like a journal paper or sitting or other things, people, scientists, engineering try to work into about the precipitation, humidity, winds, other things that is about the meteorological data. That's how it's changed. And come to the in our field, that is about the water resources, about the agriculture as well, that is the change of, for example, runoff, water yield, agricultural productivity, that is change when the climate is changed. That is the thing that people try to understand it now. I will show you later. So let's see about the evidence. Let's see about the evidence to prove that we are facing about the climate change. Here is the data from the GISS, from the NASA, try to show about the temperature anomaly, not just like about the temperature. The temperature anomaly that is compared from 1951 to 1980, that is showing that look at the trend of the temperature that is rising up. Until this is early. Now we are sitting in 2022, right? So this is a bit of like finish early. But you can see about the trend of the data that is climbing, that is rising. So they said that 2016 was the warmest year in the record. But now we are 2022 here, that is finished around 2019, something like that. So just like maybe now we have the new record. But from this figure that is showed as 2016 was the warmest year in the record. Let's see, another thing that is a scientist use for the evidence to prove about the climate change that I talk about it, that is about the carbon dioxide. So the amount of the carbon dioxide that is the unit that is ppm part per million that is showing the rising up as well from before the around the 20 until 2015 until around almost 2020. So that is the carbon dioxide that is rising up as well. I think that is NOAA, that is the source for the data, that is very good for the data that you can look to the data about the climate change and other thing about the meteorological data or also about the hydrological data in the NOAA. So that is the brief summary things about the climate change. So now let's see about the impact. When we talk about the climate change, we look to that, okay, what is the greenhouse gas? What is about the greenhouse effects? What the cause of the global warming? We talk about the greenhouse gas that is come from transportation, come from just like a manufacturing. So now how the impact? Impact of climate change, I try to look to the on-water resources and also most of you come from the agricultural area. So try to look to the like productivity as well. So the topic that we are going to see that is who is working on the climate change, what the agency that is working on the climate change and where that if we can get the data that we can use this to continue studying about the climate change, how to estimate the impact, what the model that you can use, and what kind of the method that people use to estimate impact. We need to look to the image and scenario that is quite important for the climate change because of image and scenario try to tell you about how is going to, how the earth is going to be in the future. But under climate change scenario, some people make the confusion between forecast, prediction, projection. But actually in the climate change area, when we talk about the projection or about the prediction, we talking about under climate change scenario only. Not just like forecasting from the data from the past, it's not like that. But from the scenario that make it from the model and under the climate change scenario, I will show you later. And then talking about the degree of certainty in assessment, why we have to talk about the degree? Because of we are working on about the future scenario. So when we talk about the future scenario, it means that it's not happening yet. So we're not sure about that, so that we need to look to the degree of the certainty and impact of climate change at the final part. Here is the organization. Organization that is how it's useful. It's useful for you if you want to work, start to work in the climate change field or just like if you're already working in the climate change field, maybe it helps you to search more data in detail. We have the organization working in the climate change, start with the observation and monitoring. So for observation and monitoring, it means that we need to look about the index or about the factor that is cause of the climate change and also impact from climate change as well. So we need about the observation, we need just like a long period for monitoring. That is Global Framework Climate Survey, that is the combination of the World Meteorological Organization and IPCC, that is the main part of the climate change that you can see a lot of the data from their website. That is Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, tied to assessment of climate change and try to make the policy. Part of that is policy as well. We have the organization that look about the research, making about the modeling, use the climate model, try to make the prediction. That is GFCS. We have the Climate Service Information System, that is the scientists After finishing working on the model, get the results, they try to establish the result to other people, other scientists all around the world, that other scientists, other engineering can use all those data and try to look to the impact in their area, in their study field, in the region, in the country. So that's why this is the main part of the climate service information system. We also have the policy that is come from United Nations Environment Program. So the policy that is what we are going to do, that is when we affect the climate change, we are talking about the adaptation, mitigation and adaptation that is come to the main part right now from the climate change. We are not going to stop only know how it's changed. Just like, okay, that is we have the change of the rainfall pattern that is affect the crop calendar, for example, or affect the flood or drought in some area. And so the main part of this that is about the adaptation and mitigation. What is the strategy that is we can make the adaptation that people can live with this change of the climate? And also for mitigation, what people can do to release the greenhouse gas that is less than in the current situation. So this is just like from the adaptation and mitigation. So this organization, if you see, So from the organization that you can see, that is you can download the data from this organization, more just like the data that you can continue working on the model as well, and saw the data that some part of you working on the part of the adaptation or also about the mitigation. So you can use this data as well. Let's see to the IPCC work and about the main report that people use for the climate change. This is about the assessment report. The assessment report, that is the report that the divided to working group try to work in the climate change in different area. So the climate, the assessment report come from the first one that is from the 1990. We call it FAR. IPCC first assessment report, that it has the three main working group. This is about the scientific assessment, so try to look to the part of the physics about the science thing in the atmosphere, about engineering, about the combination of the gas, something like that. Impact of the assessment of climate change, that it how climate change impact to the people or to the globe. And so about to the response strategy that is start from the beginning, that is 1990. And what is next? Next, 1995 is around 4 or 5 years. IPCC is going to give a new assessment report. Why we have new? Because you think that when we time passed for around 5, 6, 7 years, we have the new technology. We have the development of the computer, supercomputer, just like coming up. So we can study more about the atmosphere and about the climate change. So for the second assessment report, we call it SAR. Still that have the three working group at the same thing, but you can see that now they add adaptation and mitigation to the SAR as well. That they didn't say anything. Maybe they say something, but not emphasize about that at the FAR. But in the SAR, they have the main part of the adaptation, mitigation, and also they have economic and social dimension as well. So in 1995, you can see that more scientists, more engineering, more people now try to look to the economy and social part in the SAR. From 1995, we move to the TAR, that is around 2001. For the 2001, also they have the three main working group and synthetic report that is about the scientific basis come again. So the first one is most about the scientific thing. If you want to look to see in the details, go to the website IPCC, try to look to the report of the working group one. And then if you look to the impact, you look to the adaptation, you look to the vulnerability, try to look to the working group two and three about the mitigation. And if you look through more about that, some part of that have the region, the effect impact each region as well, just like North America, Asia, Middle East, something like that, have in a region. So now we are IPCC fourth assessment report. For fourth assessment report here, that is, I think that it is a little bit mistaken, that is around 2007, that is physical science-based impact adaptation and mitigation as well. When I study about the climate change, and just like when I come back to the university, that is around AR4, that is study about the IPCC AR4 for climate change. Now we come to the AR5 and AR6. If you look through the paper now, not many people, I think no one work on AR4 right now. We come to the AR5 and AR6 right now. And less people study AR5 and more people come to the AR6. AR6 is new. It launched in around 2020 and around 2021. Some part of the report is have not finished yet, but also we also have the data from the global climate model already. And if you're interested in the studying about this, maybe people try to compare the result about AR5, AR6. That is, people used to do it before, compare the result about AR4 and AR5. So what the main thing that is different from each AR4, AR5, and AR6, this is about the emission scenario that is different. That is the main part of the different, that is emission scenario. Even also that is about mitigation, adaptation, policy that is different, but it's come from the result of the emission scenario that is come from the model that we will see it. Also, we also have the spatial report as well. If you're working on the spatial or just like a specific area, if you are in the managing risk, if you want to work in risk and extreme, if you want to look only flood and drought, extreme event, typhoon or other things, you also have the risk or extreme event for the adaptation. We also have, if you some of you work in the department of like related to about the land development, land use change, forestry, also have the report that is specific in this area as well. So you can go through, because of the report, each one is quite big. So maybe just like it's easier for you just like to look to the detail that you want. So this is a land use change and forestry. So, and also have the methodological report that it guide you about the detail of the study, just like guidance. And this one is from Kyoto Protocol. It's just like from 1930, that is the, we have protocol that is agreement from the other country that is try to reduce the greenhouse gas. And also that is practice guidance for land use and land use change and forestry as well. So here all of this is about the report that you can look to it and find the information for each specific thing that you are working on it or you are studying on it. So here this. So now we come to the how. That is the main part for today, that is how. Because of if you work in the field you need to know how to estimate the impact of climate change that maybe you can adapt to use it in your area or in your country. In the impact of climate change, when we look to the hydrological field, water resources management, agricultural area, we try to estimate, you can see this by, let me just a second, by defining scenario. So that's why I said it before, but defining scenario is quite important. Because of if you're not defining the scenario that you are studying, you don't know exactly how it's going to be in the future, what's the impact that is going to happen. So defining the scenario for change of the climate, that is quite important. And also we have the model. I'm not sure that have any one of you heard about the general circulation model before or not. This is Ahmed. I like to talk to someone sometimes, but Ahmed, have you heard about the general circulation model before?
No, Dr. This is first time I heard.
Oh, okay. So because of when we talk about the climate change, the thing that is important is about the general circulation model. So for the general circulation model, I'm going in detail later, but let's see in the three key developments, how to develop the estimated impact of climate change. The first one that is the main thing that I just said that is about the constructing scenarios. Constructing scenario that suitable for interesting areas. It means that when we see the scenario, you will see that is that is suit for you or not in the area of your study or in the region and your region. And then develop the result, develop the data, develop the model using realistic model. Why? Because of when you work in this area, there are many climate models all around the world. Not all the country that working have the climate model. For example, in Thailand, my country, we don't have our own general circulation model. We don't have it. So we try to get the data from other country, from the model, from just like from European, from Japan, from North America, for example. So developing and use various model and try to link or try to understand about the link between climate and the result that you're studying. For example, if precipitation change, you know that for sure runoff change, you know that for sure is going to affect, continue effect to the crop calendar, to agricultural production. Try to link the feedback of the climate change. For example, another thing in temperature change. If temperature change, yesterday you, Dr. Varawood talking about the ETO, if you can remember that, evapotranspiration. So it means that if temperature change, evapotranspiration will change because it's related, right? So it means that try to link it, the feedback, try to link, find the reason that is okay if the temperature change, how is going to affect in our area or is going to affect about maybe you need to move a little bit before or after about the crop calendar in some region, for example. So this is the three key developments.
Doctor, I have more point to clarifications. What the term of scenario here? What does refer to, and can you provide the realistic or more specific example about the scenario?
And okay, go ahead.
Yes, and one more thing related to the climate downscaling or something like that. I'm not quite sure about this kind of a term. It may be related to a general circulation model.
Yes. Okay. The climate scenario. I will talk all of this your question after this. Okay. About the emission scenario, I will talk about this, and about the downscaling, I also talking about this as well. So let me give in the details about this, and then if you want to more clarify, you can ask it later. Okay. In just like maybe 3-4 slides, you will see about the emission scenario.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Okay. So now that is the key development of the how you can estimate the impact of climate change, if you are interested in this. And then let's go to the next one. It's not moving. Okay. Here is his main thing, and this is from the paper from Hakala. That is, I like the figure that is from his from their paper, showing that the step that you try to estimate or try to find the change from the climate change to your area. I mean, it's going to start with the emission scenario that I'm going to talk about that. Then it's going to look to the general circulation model. What is this? And how about the resolution? How the general circulation model work? Go to the regional climate model that is part of the downscaling that you asked. And also go to about the hydrological model that I'm talking a bit. So all of this is the step that we can use it in general to study about the impact of the climate change on the your related field. You don't have to use your hydrological models. You can use just like a crop model, just like a crop walk that you studied yesterday. Continue using the crop walk after pass all of this step, and then using the crop walk. And it's okay as well. That's because of crop walk need the meteorological data related to about the productivity. So at the end, it doesn't have to be hydrological model. It can be other model as well. But we need to work this step first before forcing the model, the input data to another model that you are interested. Okay. So what is emission scenario? Emission scenario, that is the thing that you try to predict, try to project about the greenhouse gas emission in the future. So the emission scenario, the first one that they study about the emission scenario that is come from this report, if you want to look to the detail, is from the special report on emission scenario that is SRES from the IPCC that I show you before. So from its emission scenario, to try to generate radiative forcing data. How the different of the radiative forcing data is going to be under the different scenario, and then put that data to the GCM, Global Climate Model. So let's see about the emission scenario first. The first one of the emission scenario, if you look to the climate change paper in the past around AR4 or before that a bit, you will see, I bet you that you will see A1, A2, B1, B2. That is the scenario. That is the emission scenario that they try to look to the change of the Earth in the future by consider other things, for example, population, economic, technology, energy, land use, agriculture. If you look to the A1, A1 is here. A1 is the part of the global and part of the going close to economic. It means that what? It means that now if we work in under the A1 scenario, it means that a world of rapid economic growth and rapid introduction of new and more efficient technology. What does this mean? It means that if we work to the A1 scenario, it means that we don't consider in the future. We don't consider that we don't care about the climate change. We don't have the mitigation. We don't care about the environment. If we live just like that, how is going to be in the future? So scientists try to say that how the population go in the future, just like increase more than 10 times, for example, what is going to be? What is about the radiative forcing? How they know about the radiative forcing? It means that they know that about the greenhouse gas is going up, just like it large, going very high. So that's why A1 that is showing that, okay, close to economy, care less about the environment, go to the global. Let's say about the B2 scenario, what is going to happen about the B2 scenario? B2 scenario come to the regional, close to the regional, as you can see, and come to the part of the environment. So it means that in under scenario, under B2 scenario, this world try to take care of the earth, look about the local solution, about economic, and look about the sustainability, environmental sustainability. So if you think about if we care about the earth, we try to reduce using electricity, try to use just like electricity car, instead of just like a fossil fuel, something like that, greenhouse gas is going to drop. So when greenhouse gas is going to drop, it means that the forcing radiation comes just like keep in the earth less. So this is the way that they try to make the assumption and try to look that if the world going A1, what is going to happen? If the world go to A2, B1, B2, what is going to happen? In detail, they also have the, let me see. In detail, they also have just like, this is A1 story, A2 story, B1 story, B2 story. You can see this. And also for A1 is going to have just like in sub A1, A1, F1, fossil intensive. A1T, non-fossil energy source, A1B, balance across all sources. So they put this kind of, try to calculate, try to look to this kind of the condition and try to look to the world, what is going to happen under A1, A2, B1, B2. Don't remember A1, A2, B1, B2 because of it's quite old fashioned now. Not many people working about the AR4 or just like SIES story. But you can look through the paper if you want to know more. But most people now working on AR6 right now, AR5 and AR6. Let's see to the graph in here. You see the graph here, you will see the global surface warming, how the temperature is going to change under each scenario. So I emphasize this again, this is not forecasting. This is about projection. If you talk about forecasting, you are saying you are talking about using the data in the past, try to look to the future, that is forecasting. It means that last week, the temperature around this, there was rain last week. How about next week? That is forecasting. When we talk about the climate change, we're talking about projection in the future under climate change scenarios. Why I emphasize this? Because of many people confuse that and that try to compare the results of projection under climate change with the result that is compared with the forecasting result that is different. It is not the same. this is different. So when we do the project, when you do the projection or when you do about the prediction under climate change, you need to emphasize that. That is not forecasting from the data from the past, but this is the projection under the scenario things that is the scientists make an assumption. So that you can see that here, that is 20th century, that is the real thing, the observation. But when you put it under climate change scenario, you will see if A2, that is storyline, that is about the economic emphasis a bit, and also about the global, look to the global all around the world, how it's going to be. A2 is quite high. Look to the B1 is blue one here. The temperature of B1 is quite a bit lower compared to other scenarios. Why is like that? Because of B1 going concern about the environmental sustainability, it's about the economic, it's about the social. Look to this. They has the clean and resource efficiency. So they has the clean energy, for example. So the temperature is not rising compared to the A1B and B1. So this is different. So let's see another thing. From AR4, SIES and AR4, we come to the new one that is look about the AR5. They change the word, they change the vocabulary, they change the word from A1, B1, A2, B2 to the new one. If you go to the paper, academic paper, you will see the word RCP. RCP that is come from representative concentration pathway. It means that now they try to look scientists or people who working about this, they try to look to the radiative forcing. So they have RCP 2.6, RCP 4.5, RCP 6, and 8.5. Each RCP is related to about the radiative forcings. That is, for example, RCP 8.5 showing that higher than 8.5 watt for square kilometer, watt for square meter in 21st century. That is higher, very high. RCP 4.5, that is 4.5 watt square meter after 21st century. So here that is the new thing for the assumption of the scenario that people use nowadays, that is AR5, but it's not the newest one. So let's look to the graph of the AR5. Look to the graph. When look to the graph of the AR5, you will see this the y-axis that is showing the amount of the carbon dioxide in the part per million. And here it is about a year. RCP 2.6 showing less, that is less radiative forcings compared to other RCP. So carbon dioxide in the air, in the earth, that is quite low compared to other scenario. Let's see to the RCP 8.5, that is quite should higher, the highest one, showing that RCP 8.5, this is not the extreme, just like the largest scenario. So if you want to look to the event that is the largest event effect from the climate change, maybe you will see, you will try to look or use the data under RCP 8.5. scenarios. That is about how the extreme event is going to be. That is, how about the precipitation? How about the temperature? How about the humidity under RCP 8.5 is going to be? Because of now RCP 8.5 showing highest carbon dioxide equivalent in ppm. But if you don't want to go to the extreme size, you don't want to go quite low, look, see a bit, maybe you can select RCP 2.6 or RCP 4.5. So when people study about the climate change, one thing that they usually do that is just like try to compare between scenario, what is happened about RCP 2.5, what it happened in RCP 4.5 and 8.5. So that is true to compare. That is one thing that you can do from the in the AR5. And also you can also compare AR5 and AR4 as well. How the thing that in the scientists think about the RCP and about the AR4, for example, RCP 8.5 showing the carbon dioxide around 1370 ppm, temperature rising up around 4.9, is close to A1F1 of the AR4. This is the way that they try to compare the knowledge or the information from the past and then develop the knowledge until now and in the future. So RCP 6.0 that is showing carbon dioxide around 850, close to SRESB2. So they try to compare what's the new thing compared to the previous one. What is the difference? So here is the one thing of the researcher do compare each other, compare RCP with the A1, B1. But we also have the new one, as I told you, from AR4, from AR5. Now we have the new one and the new word, new vocabulary. That is, we need to make sure that we understand about that. Oh, sorry, that is, let's see about the compared to AR4 and AR5 first. AR4 and AR5, what is the difference in the model and in the scenario that they make? They try to improve the original information, just like all phenomenon on AR5, they put just like, you know, about the El Nino, La Nina, about the monsoon in the model. They put the interaction between the clouds and aerosol in the model, change of the carbon cycle, look to the ocean acidification, and look to the future climate change in the long divided projection in the near term and long term projection. So here is the new thing in the AR5. So each step, AR4, AR5 has a new thing. AR5 and AR6 also has the new thing. The new thing in what? The new thing in the model that they want to calculate is mean that you have the computer that is high efficiency for calculation. It means that you can do more in the try to make it more results and then try to make it more close to realistic under each scenario. So now let's come to the AR6. AR6, we call it that is newer. Now we talk about the AR6, we talk about SSP, Shared Socio-Economic Pathway. We have the new one. The concept is just like close to the AR4 and AR5. That is, we have the assumption we have under the each scenario that is going, what is going. So SSP that is try to develop, look to the future socio-economic development. So we have the five broad narrative of the SSP. SSP try to use the driver of the SSP that is use energy use, air pollution control, land use, greenhouse gas emission, that is developed from the, there is the model called integrated assessment model that is come from many models. Try to integrate it together. I will show you. Let's see the AR6 first. AR6 divided two main one, that is five main one, SSP, share socio-economic pathway. From SSP1 until SSP5, first, I have the explanation right here. SSP1, we have the one thing called SSP1 1.9. It means that it is in the assumption of this world is going to be sustainability, concern about the sustainability. That is SSP1. SSP2 and SSP3, that is quite in the middle of the road. And SSP5, that it go fossil fuel development, that is not concerned much about the green technology, about the environment sustainability. SSP5 is doesn't care about it much. And then they also compare SSP with the RCP, the previous ones as well, and show that SSP1, that is the new thing. So that is nothing about the scenario or about the result that is can compare with the RCP for the previous one. But SSP1 2.6, that is the radioactive fossil, the number of the radioactive fossil. So SSP1 2.6, that is go to the same thing with the RCP previous scenario, that is RCP 2.6. And also we have other SSP as well, SSP2 4.5, close to RCP's 4.5. We also add other things more in, scientists add other things more in the SSP. So here is just like the emission scenario that when you try to work, you need to report which scenario that you use to estimate the impact of climate change in this study. For example, if you study about which scenario that you use, which scenario you use and why you use this scenario and how the difference between scenario is going to be. So this is the main part that's when I submit the paper, and then reviewer always asks me about that all the time, actually, because of, it's the main thing that why you use this, why you compare this, why you select this for your country. Another thing, so we have SSP1 1.9, SSP1 2.6, SSP2 4.5, SSP3 7.0, until SSP5 8.5. You will notice that when we come to the largest number, SSP5 8.5, this is the high reference scenario with no additional climate policy. It means that if we're going to continue to happen, if we don't care about the climate policy, if we don't care to reduce the emission gas, what is going to happen, what is going to be? So emission as high as SSP5 8.5 within fossil fuel. So this is the all scenario until up to now that people use. And if you want to start, or maybe you already study about it, and if you or you want to start study about it, you can start just like from AR5 to AR6. It's going to be just like up to date until now. Okay, this is another figure showing about the challenge, low challenge adaptation, challenge for mitigation, looking about each SSP, where is this right now. But this figure quite well because of they add about educational level here as well. So if we just like try to put people to have a higher educational level, what is going to be? in SSP 1, SSP 2, and SSP 3, 4, 5. Okay. Here is the result. Here is the global temperature under climate change scenario. Here is the SSP. SSP, let's see to the SSP. We will have the CMIP6 scenario. I will talk about this later. We have, if you look to the SSP, for example, carbon dioxide concentration under SSP. This is the way that people like to plot the graph of climate change. They try to start from 1980, that is the main as well. They try to start from 1980, try to use the measurement of the carbon dioxide, the real one, the measurement of the carbon dioxide. And then after that, from SSP, that is start from, in the model, start from 2015. From 2015 is going to be the results under the model, under the climate change scenario. So from 2015 until 2099, 21st century, that is going a little bit higher for SSP 5, 8.5, and the largest one, the highest one, that is SSP 5, 8.5, of the carbon dioxide concentration. And again, for the SSP 1, 2.6, is the lowest one of the carbon dioxide. It's coming like this because of the emission scenario that you put the model, that is people care about the climate policy tied to try to reduce the greenhouse gas. So that's why the carbon dioxide is low. That is the global surface temperature. Mostly carbon dioxide and global surface temperature, the trend of the SSP is going to be similar, most of them. But precipitation is a bit different because many factors than temperature. So that's why if you look through the paper, don't be curious or don't be surprised if sometime you will see that precipitation in some area, SSP 1, 2.6, that is higher than SSP 3, 7.0, something like that. Because for the precipitation and other meteorological factor or other index is not going, sometimes it's not going to be like this. It's not going to be the same trend, just like the carbon dioxide and also temperature. Okay. So here is the emission scenario, AR5 and AR6. Now, researcher try to compare. When we have the new AR, when we have the new assessment reports of like AR5 or AR6 come out, most scientists or most researchers working this area try to publish the paper and try to compare with the previous one. First, let's compare with the previous one. What's the difference? Let's compare to the different scenario, what is going to be. So they can make just like that. They can publish a paper, try to give the knowledge what is going to be under each scenario and compare this to the previous one. So here is the temperature. The temperature, for example, just like RCP 2.6 and SSP 1 2.6, I show you that it can compare. That the temperature is 1.6. For RCP, but when we use the new scenario, SSP 1 is a bit higher, 1.8, a bit higher. And let's see that the temperature from the RCP 8.5 and also SSP 5, 8.5, SSP 5, 8.5, a bit higher as well, 0.1 higher, 0.1 degree. So we can conclude from look to the graph that SSP 1 give a bit effect or impact in the temperature compared to the RCP is a bit higher. just like for RCP 4.5 and SSP 2.4.5, showing 2.4 and that is different. Okay, that is the projected one is compared between AR5 and AR6. Okay. Come to the second thing. When we know about the emission scenario, and when we are searching, okay, what scenario we want to study. So now, because of general circulation model that is give you the data, give you the result that you are going to continuing study. So what is general circulation model and how we can use the data? What is general circulation model? When we talk about the emission scenario, before that, we talk about the general circulation model a bit, that is use the data radiative forcing inside the scenario, put the radiative forcing from scenario inside to the climate model. Climate model just like a computer simulation, but they try to model, include most of the thing in the earth, atmosphere, ocean, land, and ice. So that is climate model. Climate model give you. Climate model give you both, just like from the past, the data from the past, present, until the future. Climate model give you not only in climate change scenario, but in the simple thing as well. It depends on what is your force into the climate. It's just like a model. So what is model is going to calculate is up to scientists or up to researcher what you are going to put inside, right? The output from the climate model helps to understand about the effect of Earth climate, see? Affecting of the Earth's climate, not only climate change, but the climate of the Earth. If you want to know how it's changed, put the scenario inside, and then you will see what the different. So here is about showing about the schematic of the global climate model. Global climate model, that is another name we call is a general circulation model. So climate model that is divided just like a grid cell, they have grid. And also not only horizontal, is showing a vertical, just like above the ground and under the ground to the ocean as well, because of the climate model have the calculation about the ocean as well. So also climate model that is a complex, that is 3D grid. The resolution of the climate model, it depends. It depends on each climate model. That is around 200 kilometers until around 500 kilometers. So you will see that climate model give you just like a cost resolution. What does it mean? It means that if you are basin, if you want to study some basin, for example, or if you want to study some provinces, some area, if inside in one grid, it means that you have only one time series data inside. But actually, it is different because of 200 until 500 kilometers, that is the resolution. So in the realistic world, around that, it is going to different. So resolution of the climate model is cost. So if people want to study about the basin or just like about the local scale, they need to do, it's come to another word, downscaling. Try to make the grid or data inside the GCM or inside the climate model make it just like finer, less cost. That is the way. For the climate model, what is inside required that if physical science, they need to have to start to calculate about the physical thing, chemical, biological process. They also have just like a stat model, computational science is about the error analysis, data mining, trend analysis, also about the mathematical. So not many, just like only some country that have the can run general circulation model. So who does climate model around the world? Who does the climate model, and how you can use the data from the climate model? If you guys already know that if you want to study about, for example, now I'm studying about the stream flow from the climate model. I need to know that is who does the climate model that give the results about the stream flows, and then I'm going to continue working on that, just like a download data and then continue working. So you need to know who does the climate model. Who does the climate model that is all around the world? Let's see about the name. The name of the model that is come from about the name of the organization or about the center that developed the model. The first one, for example, made of Fit Hanley Center, that is we call the model HAD, GEM3. This is from the Hadley, we call the model HAD. We also have the model that is NOAA Geophysical Fluid Dynamic Laboratory, GFDL, that is a system model as well. So we have many countries working from the working about the climate model. Here I show you can go to this website, and then you will see that which country working on the climate model. For example, if you click that, you will see that, oh, okay, in US, there is the climate model called CESM1, come from the Community Earth System Model. Okay, so now you know that you can download the model. And when you use the model, when you work in the climate change, when you use the model, you need to define or you need to put the name of the model inside. Because of what? Because of different model, different organization, they use the a little bit different about the calculation or maybe about the initial system that is working with the model that is different. So you need to put it, you need to put the name of the model inside because of they show you a result that is quite different. Okay, so this is, if you go to the website, you can see that, okay, in Asia, what is the country? In Africa, what the country working on the model? Here is the name. This is some, this is not all, but I show you about the example of the name of the model and on the country that working on about the general circulation model. We have Norway, that is the model that is called BCM2.0. We have Australia, we have Canada, have the China, USA, England, United Kingdom, in Italy, United Kingdom that is HAD, that I just showed you that, France, Maroc is from Japan, that is people also use as well. Maroc 3, MRI, HAD, and also ECHAM, you will see it a lot. And CSIO, that is from Australia also, you will see it. So you can, so now you know that that is different country, have different model, give the different result. So the important thing that is how we are going to select to use the model, which model that we should use, because of we are a lot of the model side. They also have the research paper comparing between model. That is, okay, let's compare about the temperature for the SSP scenario, just like from the from different model, and let's see what is the result, how big different. And I can tell that is quite different. It's quite different if you select. So if you select only one model to study in your area or in your research, for example, is a bit risky because of you not sure that is how about other model is going to give you the result. So let's say that compare the model that is much better. Or another thing, if you look to the academic paper, and fortunately that is there are people working in your area, in your region, in your country, and they already conclude that, okay, this model that is work because of they try to compare from different model and show that maybe just like, for example, maybe just like Myrock tree that is work for this area and is close to the data from observation data. So you can select and then use that. There are another word that you need to know about the climate change. We call it, most people call it CMIP. CMIP, that is just like Carbon Model Intercomparison Project, that is CMIP. What is the CMIP do? CMIP, that is about the institutions from various countries, from other region, that is try to cooperate for developing and running the model. So the CMIP, that is the framework that when we do about the experiment of about the climate model, when you try to work it together, it means that you try to start and then set up the initial state at the same way. So if you try to do that, you can compare, you can validate, you can analyze, and you can look to the what is different, who is going to be close, whose result is going to be close with the observation, and why it's like that. You can improve the GCM together. So that's why that is CMIP that is come to in the climate change area. That is the way that is many institutions try to develop the model, help each other. That is called CMIP. We come to CMIP 6, CMIP 6 right now, just like we have AR 6. So now we come to CMIP 6. Yes, I'm reading the question in the chat. They ask you asked that wondering if the climate model can be accessed freely. If the climate models can be accessed, the results, the data, the output of the climate model, you can access that. I will show you. So now, how do institutions cooperate for developing and running the model? So try to set up the beginning of the model in the same way. Try to use the same input data so they can develop or they can improve the model much better. So let's see here, that is another thing that is cooperation. So they have just like a group of the cooperation that they try to work together. For example, some scientists or some research want to focus on the chemistry and aerosol in the atmosphere. So they go to the group of air chemistry, MIP. For me, for Codex, that is one thing that is interesting. Codex, that is, they try to downscale using regional downscaling. I will talk about it later. Try to downscaling and then look to the impact of the model. And then for me, I use a lot that is this one, that is scenario MIP, that is for people used to look to the different scenario of the result from the result of the model. So this is the one. So it depends on what people interest, and then they look for each topic. Okay, I would like to switch a bit because I will show you how to download the data. Just a second. I need to switch to this one. Okay. I'm not sure that you see the Firefox showing the WCRP as I show. Ahmed, I have, because you're only one, so I need to ask you that. Oh, I see you play. You see that, right?
No, I didn't see the
final. No, no.
Oh, no? Okay, so just a second. I need to stop
sharing. No, no.
Oh, thank you. I will share it again with this one. Okay. Here. I hope that you see it, right? CMIP sick that I take it?
Yeah.
Okay. I can see. Thank you. So here is the way.
Yeah, we see it.
Okay, thank you very much. So here is the website. I put it in the slide that you can download freely about to working on about the climate change. This is called the CMIP6. The result of this data, this is the file called .nc, if you're familiar with the NC file. The NC file is quite big. Why did we use NC file? Because it comes with the large amount of the data. If you can remember that, this is about the grid around the world. So that's why the NC file can store a large amount of the data. If you take, you see that CMIP6, I'm not going to all the bar in here. I will show you some and then you can play it. Because we have only just like a 3 hours. I need to finish all the things first, okay? So we have a CMIP6. The main part that I will show you that here first, CF, I come just like down because of I'm family. I used to do like this. Standard name, what you want to in what you want to study, what the data that you want. If you want precipitation, go down to find precipitation. If you want air pressure, go down to find air pressure. You want rainfall, you want, if for example, I want surface or precipitation, for example. So you need to find just a second. They we have PM2.5 as well, PM10. We have a lot. And then OP, okay, precipitation. Let's say that precipitation flux. You tick it. Okay. And then enter. Let's see a bit. You will see the result. That is the number of the result that is 86,000 something, that is quite big. Okay, that is come all the result. You can download it. Let's go another thing. So now you select only one that is showing the result here. This is CF standard name. Here is the variable, is mean that you need to, you can select precipitation or only precipitation max. You can select it, up to you. I'm not going to put in here, but I'm going to go to frequency. You need the data in 3 hours, 6 hours, daily, monthly or not, which one that you want to use. Which one that, for example, if I want monthly data, if I want to see if my model need only monthly data, I can download only monthly data to study. So I take monthly data and then enter it. The result is less compared to the other things. It show only monthly data in here, but not. Go a bit to go to, I will go to the experiment ID. Experiment ID will give you, if you can remember that the different topic for each people interest, just like codex, if you can remember the last slide, or just like about the scenario. I will go to the scenario. There is a historical data. They are going to have just like a hintcast. You know the hintcast, right? Just like the thing that you calculate and compare it into the past. It's called just like a hintcast. You already have the, let's see, this here, SSP, 126, that is the thing that we just talk about, SSP 12.6. If you want to study only SSP 12.6, you can click it. Or if you want to study more SSP 37.0, you can click it. Enter. It's going to give you 700 something, the results give less because you select only these two scenarios. Okay. Another thing that I want to show here is the name of the model. If you can remember that, let me see, SIRO. That is from Australia, if I can remember it right. Or just like we also have MyROC, if you can remember from the last slide, from the previous slides, MyROC is from Japan. Which model that you want to download? Click it. It's going to give you only MyROC. And you will see search constraint in here that is showing which condition that you search. Now you try to search CMIP6. You will want to study precipitation. You want to get the data for monthly data. You want SSP 12.6 or SSP 37.0. You need only MyROC data from the MyROC model. Okay. They also have the resolution for you. MyROC model can produce from now, we know that MyROC model can produce 250 kilometers and also 500 kilometers. So which resolution that you want? It depends. This depends on your study that if you want just like a less resolution, finer, you can go to the 250 kilometer. So if I select 250 kilometer, give the condition. So you get 250 kilometer. So now you have 53 results. So now you have, let's see to the result a bit. This one is chose CMIP6 scenario MIP from MyROC, from the model MyROC6, that is the name of the model, the version of the model SSP 12.6, that is the scenario. R2I1 P1 F1, this is the valiant rebel here. It means that how they start, how they initiate at the beginning of the model. That is the definition. I didn't put it in here. It's quite in details. And if someone need that, the definition of that, you can just like contact me. Please kindly drop record video in Google Classroom because the course is so old. Okay, I will drop the course. I read the chat and I will drop the video and the website. Okay, so let's see that. So 12.6. R1I1P1F1, I will give you in detail later because of it's quite in detail. That is the initial setting up the model that is quite different. Okay. And also this is about the precipitation, monthly precipitation. How you can download this? First, let's see to the metadata. This is the metadata. If you familiar using with the NC5 or just like for me, I use MATLAB, open the NC5. But if you search in the Google, you will see a lot of people using in the just like a technique or just like what is called just like a program to open the NC5 is different. So for me, I use the MATLAB open the NC5. So here is the slide metadata showing the date and time that is from 2015 until 21st century. That is the last, the start of the 21st century. That is SSP 12.6. That is the area, latitude and longitude of this. And also give you just like a name that is precipitation. This is the flux. So this is the unit of this. and how we can download is go to list file. Let's close high metadata first. Here is the file. So you can click download it in here, HTTP download. It depends. Maybe it seems like taking you forever, but it's not like that, but it's quite long time as well. I have to just like download it and leave the computer just like open many hours. It depends on how many files that you download, but the file is quite big. So that's why. And I'm not going to click it because I'm afraid that my computer cannot torrent this file, okay? That is the different one. So you click here, HTTP download, and then it's download. Another file that you can work with that is OpenApp. OpenApp is we have it in MATLAB as well. So you can use it both. For HTTP download, that is OpenApp. When download it, you can open it. You will see the name of the file that is quite long, and this is the last one is point and NC, that is called NC file. So you can work with this for the downloading the data. If you want to select the new one, just delete it. Let me delete all of this. Again, when you delete it, it come out with the result that is quite big for MCMIP6. And if you want to start with the topics that your interest, that is the one thing that I show you in the last slide, it's just like a circle one, which one that your interest, you can select from here as well. For example, here, again, if I select scenario MIP and then select it. Okay, it's sure that scenario MIP come that is quite a large amount of the data. And then going to show you again about the model that now is a lot of the model because you haven't select which variable that you want to study. So now it's just like you select from the beginning. Okay, you want to select only scenario MIP. Which model have scenario MIP? Which model give the result of the scenario MIP a lot? MPI, NOR-ESM2, I use it a lot as well. And also about the CNRM, CAN-ESM5, that is from Canada. We use it just like from CAN-ESM2. And then, for example, if you select CAN-ESM5, you will see that which variable that CAN-ESM5 produce come down, and you will see. This is the variable only produced or only generated by CAN-ESM5. So how you are going to constrain selecting the data, it depends on you. You can working or playing with this thing. You can just like, for me, I like to select the resolution that is quite final, so 100 kilometer, for example. Come to see it again, what we have. Just like for now, I'm trying to work it on the runoff that is 50 kilometer. We have it as well. So I hope that you get the idea how to select the data and how to use the data that you can continue working with that. So here is the experiment ID. Oh, they have from RCP as well, that is from CMIP5, and also that is SSP from CMIP6 or AR6, that is here. You can even select comparing. I'm trying. This is new for me as well because I never see that it's come together. Okay. That is list file showing metadata. Yeah. So try to if you want to work on this, try to play with this one. But let me remind you a bit. Here is the result from general circulation model or global climate model. It's quite coarse. Is the resolution is just like large. It's difficult for you if you want to study in the local scale because of their resolution. So from here, anyone has any question? I'm going back to the slide. This is all okay. So I'm going back to the slide. Continue to the downscaling. Let's see the downscaling. Okay. We come to this. Actually, when I teach a student for 3 hours, we used to have a break. But for the training, there is no one tell me that we should have a break. So I'm going to continue. Okay. But maybe just like we can finish earlier because we don't have a break. That's the thing. Okay, let's see that. Okay, so here is the thing that I show you. Another thing that is codex. Codex that is the what is called the people or the scientists try to do the downscaling, and then they put the result of the downscaling just like try to make the result of the GCM final. So they put it in the codex. Codex now that is the result from AR5 and also AR6 just start beginning. I think I haven't, to tell you the truth, I haven't checked much in Codex yet for the AR6, but for the AR5, I used to get the data from the Codex because Codex give you the resolution is final, that is good to use. Maybe in your country. So you can visit the website in the Codex as well. That is, you can see Codex South Asia, Codex East Asia, Codex Mediterranean. Okay. So now let's come to the next one. When we have the general emission scenario, we have the general circulation models. We already have the output from the general circulation model. Now we want to use it. We need to put it in the process that is called downscaling. If in case that you want to compare only, for example, only scenario, compare AR6 to AR5, compare about the variable that you're interested without concerning about going in detail of each region, you do not need to use the downscaling. You can compare it directly, but in case just only in case that you don't care much about the resolution, just like want to know AR4 and AR5, want to know that is just like, for example, wind velocity, how is different AR4, AR5, each scenario, how different. You don't need to use the downscaling. But if now you're working, you want to, for example, working in the specific basin, specific region, and want to use the data from the GCM as well, you do need to pass the downscaling process. Okay, what is the downscaling process? Downscaling process, that is the process that you can try to adjust the resolution to obtain or to get the higher spatial resolution. For example, from 150 to 300 kilometer, the output from GCMs. But you want to study in the local scale in your basin, so you try to apply the coarse scale climate change projection. So you want to change from the coarse scale to just like get the higher spatial resolution. Final, you have need to pass the, it's called Regional Climate Model or RCM. Oh, I missed one part. GCM and RCM, this is the physical based model, both of GCM and RCM. What does this mean? It means that they use just like that, the thing that we already talked about the atmospheric, physical, about the atmospheric chemistry or things in the atmosphere or related to about the ground or about the ocean. All GCM and RCM, this is this kind of the model. So this is the physical based model. But when we use the GCM, we just like look through the Earth, just like the entire of the globe. But when we apply the RCM, it means that we select or we use only the data in the region from the output of the GCM and put to the regional climate model that is one of the physical based model as well. That is tied to make it just like scope the region to make it smaller. So the resolution is going a bit higher spatial resolution around 25 kilometers. It's finer. So it means that you can study in the regional scale much better compared to the general circulation model. That is much better. But we also have another thing of the downscaling. That is called statistical downscaling. Statistical downscaling using stat only. It means that it depends on the data, the quality of the data. It depends on the data, observation data in your country or in your region that you can work with the statistical downscaling. So many countries as well that can work with the regional climate model. In Codex, you can get the result from the regional climate model as well. But some people may think that that is not far enough to get the result, to get this result and to continue to the study. So some people use the statistical downscaling after passing the process of regional climate model. That is the way. So here just like showing the resolution from the GCM that is quite large, and then go to RCM final and impact model local. They can go to just like a precipitation station or local scale that is from the statistical downscaling. So for me, usually I work with the statistical downscaling using the data from GCM or using the data from RCM and continue working on in the statistical downscaling. Try to get the result that is suitable for use in very local scale. Okay. Dynamical downscaling and statistical downscaling, that is the thing that I already taught. That is dynamical downscaling that is used regional climate model, that is I already said that. And of course also statistical downscaling that I said that because of that is used the data from the observation data in the past, so that is the established relationship between historical large-scale atmosphere and local climate characteristics. It means that if you want to apply statistical downscaling, you need to make sure that the area of your study have the observation data that is, the quality is quite good, just like a long period of the time, and also less missing data. It's going to good to be good to use in the statistical downscaling. I didn't go to detail about statistical downscaling because of it's quite in detail. We have just like a linear scaling, we have one-time mapping, we have many methods, just like that we can use for statistical downscaling. But I do compare, show you the comparison about between dynamical and statistical downscaling. So dynamical downscaling or regional climate model or RCM, that is monthly time series, give the grid around 20 to 50 kilometer. But in statistical downscaling, they sort of like go to station level. As I told you, that is you have the climate station in your area, you can use the data try to make the statistical downscaling. Monthly time series and daily time series, you can do both for the statistical downscaling. And also have the, you can do the extreme event as well, that I'm also working on the extreme event as well about the using the, just like a GEV, if you know that. Just like a general extreme value, try to work to the extreme event from the climate change. But dynamical downscaling requires very high computational resources and expertise. It means that's why not all the country have the RCM. In Thailand also we also have, but maybe I think that in most of your country, you have RCM as well. In Thailand, we have only two or three organizations working RCM. But for the statistical downscaling, everyone can do it. Everyone can do it with the good quality of the data. Because of it is used low computational, you can use it just like in simple statistical program, R Studio, SPSS, or just like that. Microsoft Excel, if you apply simple basics of statistical downscaling, MATLAB. So everyone can use it. Everyone can apply the method of the statistical downscaling. Low computational, low volume of the data, sufficient, and also reliable. The result, both of this, the result is reliable. It's for the each GCM. It means that if you get the result that is close to realistic in the historical part from the GCM, you can continue working dynamical or statistical model. It depends on the result of the GCM. This is an example that is my work and it is already passed. That is, I compare to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 GCM results. I use the downscaling technique. And then go to divide it into this one is the past. In history, this one is the just like the short term, and this is the long term. So we divide it in the future under prediction scenario. And I use the SWOT model, that is called the rainforest off model. I put climate data to the SWOT model, and then try to get the water yield and surface runoff from the past and until from the future under climate change scenario. So this one I use select only SSP. Oh no, I did RCP5. I did RCP5 for this one. So this is the way that people make an estimation of the hydrological variable or hydrological data. Use the you can use other models. I use the SWOT. You can use HEC. You can use MIME. You can use other as well for the rainfall runoff model. Another thing. Oh, I select only SWOT. For another thing that is from other work. That is, they also working in just like a basin scale, use climate change scenario from HGCM, do the work with the RCP 4.5, 8.5, put it in the hydrological model, who work in the agricultural production, you can use in the, another thing, I can't remember, another thing not is crop what? Aqua crop. That is as well aqua crop that is showing you about the productivity as well. You can put it in that. And then you can look and then compare the variable or the index that you interest. Here, this work, they compare ET, evapotranspiration, surface runoff, water yield, snow melt, and also about the precipitation. So here is the way. Here is the way that people try to estimate the impact of climate change, and you can adjust it by using the different scenario, different region, different GCM, different variable, output variable, different models. Try to give more information. To in the climate change field or in the climate change areas. Okay. Here, because of I work in the SWOT, so just like give you a bit information about the SWOT model because of it's free. That I like it because of you don't have to concern much about the copyright or about the other things. Let me show you. I'm not sure there are anyone working in this about the SWOT model before. Yes or no? I will open the website. Just a second. No one answer me. Let's see the website of SWOT. Just a second. I think here. Okay. Here. I will show you because of it is free. And if you want to work on that, it's quite very useful because of the SWOT model that is there are community that's using the SWOT. It's free. You can adjust the code. And also there are just like components, a lot of components, not only about the hydrological, it's about the landslide, it's about the sediment yield, it's about the water quality, it's about the land management, land practice. So you can work on this, and this is not that complicated. So what that is interface that you can use with the ArcSWOT or you can use with the QSWOT as well. If you're familiar with the GIS, you can use with this. And also they also have the SWOT CAP that is the model that try to help you to calibrate the model. You already know that, right? If you just like use any model, the one thing that you need to do is about the model calibration. So if you do the most, you need to, thank you for the answer in the chat box. So I hope that you can look through this and this is very useful model and is freely. So the first, I will show you about the, I'm not going to show you about the model because now 11 something. So I will show you about workshop. How you are going to start? That is the workshop that is watch instruction video in here, in the workshop tab bar. This is very useful because of instruction video in here is quite in detail. that you can installation and you can work it just like a step by step. Just like start with the watershed delineation. This is just like a basin scale. Watershed delineation, just like a hydrological response unit. With the data, you can put, if you in your area, or if you're concerned about the reservoir, or about the dam operation, you can put it in some part of that, you can also already put it. Or if who work in the, just like a land use, and want to look to the comparison between the land, different land use with the different landslide, different sediment yield, you can also use it as well. So it's quite very useful. So if we have time, I have the video that I can show you about, because I already teach in the basic concept of about the SWOT, that I can show you quickly about the SWOT, how to use the SWOT model. The difficult part of the SWOT, there are, I think, about around 2 and 3 difficult parts of the model. That is first, for running the model, you need to have the data. You need to make sure that in your basin or in your area have the data that is quite complete. Not have to, it doesn't have to 100% complete, but quite complete, because in SWOT they already have just like, they can automatically fill out the missing data for you. So that is quite useful, but less missing data, that is better, right? And also another thing that is a bit difficult, I need to accept that is about the calibration. Because of SWOT has many parameters that you need to adjust. It means that, for example, I did run the SWOT model for and off. There are more than 20 to 30 parameters that you need to pay attention and you need to adjust. So it depends on what your area. Maybe if you study about the sediment, maybe around 15 to 20 parameters that you need to adjust. That is a bit difficult. So let's see that if I like to remind that if you select to use SWOT, try to pay attention about the parameter. And also, but it's not that much difficult, because if you can remember, SWOT had the automatically called it SWOT cup, that sensitivity, calibration, validation, and uncertainty analysis that can do it for you. So you don't have to manually adjust one by one. You don't have to. They have the method can adjust and give you the sensitivity, the suitable data, suitable parameters, suitable value, and just like a validation for you. But you need to be patient, because of maybe you need to run a lot. I have master student that stuck it in the SWOT cup that is trying to do the calibration quite very long time as well, because of when you need to get the model results close to the observation, you need to put more effort, adjust a bit, and then try to get it more perfect. So but now they she already finished that. That's okay. So that's the main thing that need to pay attention. Okay. And also, if we have time, we will come back, because of that is very useful. That's why I talk about it. Let me go back to the slide. Okay. Okay. So now the result. One part of that, when you finish, you need to show the results. If you want to study more, or if you want to learn more about the effect of climate change, there is the result. Here is the result. For example, one of the work that is show the annual precipitation, that is showing the trend of the annual precipitation under climate change scenario. So just like from SSP1 to SSP8.5, if you see this, this is showing you about the change, that, about the precipitation that is quite rising up in the SSP5, 8.5 from 2051. So that is the way that we look to the effect of the climate change. Here is the annual water yield and also about the surface runoff compared with the precipitation. So as in general, that is not surprising that is surface runoff and also about the water yield go with the precipitation. So we can see, and then this one is comparison for each model, that is CNR, CNRM, MPI, EC, MPIR. Okay, so this is the different model in the surface runoff and water yield that is showing it hydrological. Let's talk a bit about the source of uncertainty in climate projection. For sure that because of is in the projection is not happening yet, we are talking about the future. So there are many uncertainty. The source of the uncertainty come from where? First, come from the anthropogenic emission. So natural forcing, volcanic eruption, that is the thing that is a natural thing that it may happen in the future. And also uncertainty come from the meaning of the imperfect model representation is mean that maybe each model they calculate the atmospheric component thing that is in different way, that maybe they missed some part of that is cause of the uncertainty. And also imperfect knowledge about the current climate condition, because of, as you see in Thailand, we are facing the weird thing as well. For example, that is not many year that we have the rain, just like a large rain that is in January, but now we are facing about it. That is the pattern that is changed that most people can notice that right now. Difficult in representing interannual and decadal variability in long-term project, that is a bit difficult and the sort of uncertainty as well. Another one part that is important, that is about the degree evaluation and the degree of certainty. Why I put this? Because of if you look back at the beginning slide that is showing you about the report of the IPCC, because of again that is in the future and not happening, we are not sure that how it's going to be. So we also have the degree of certainty in assessment finding and evaluated probability. What is help you? It's help you that you now you can know that the thing that IPCC give us, or that is about the scientists give us, how is going to, what is the probability that is going to happen, or is going to be like that in the future. There are two ways, that is the confidence scaling, and that is evaluate, just like the term that if you read in the IPCC report, you will see this term for sure. First, degree of certainty. There is agreement and evidence that you need to pay attention. If you see about the agreement, you will see that is low agreement, medium agreement, and high agreement. Agreement of whom? Agreement of researchers and agreement of the expertise, experts and scientists agree with this is going to happen like this in the future. That is agreement. So there are three levels of the agreement: low agreement, medium agreement, and high agreement. And also about the evidence. What is the evidence from? Evidence from the model that just like I show you before, evidence from the model, from many models, just like more than 10 model, for example. More than 10 model give is like this, that is the temperature is going up around 1.5 degrees Celsius in maybe just like 15 or 20 years, for example. That kind of evidence. If many models give the same evidence or the range of evidence is very close, it means that it shows the robust evidence, strong evidence. So for the evidence, limit evidence, medium evidence, and robust evidence, is going to give you more reliability of the data or of the result that we get. So the best one that is showing high agreement, robust evidence, the lowest one, the not bad, that is the worst one, that is low agreement and limited evidence. Another thing, this term, you will definitely see it in the report. And this term is showing what is the probability, this is likelihood it is going to happen. How is this? Virtually certain is around 99 to 100% that is definitely going to be like that. Usually, if you read the report, I read the report, I will see a lot very likely. Very likely is showing the is going to happen like that, around 90 to 100% of probability of that. And not very likely and likely, this is quite, the range is quite high, you see. Likely is show you 66 to 100% of probability. In case of very likely, it's 90 to 100% of probability. So if you see very likely or likely, it's quite different, okay? What is going to happen in the future? Another thing that we have that is about showing, okay, that is the results of AR6 warming project. That is, this is show you very likely. If you can remember that, very likely is showing 90 to 100%. It means that this result showing 90% or more than 90% is going to happen like this. That is the meaning of that. So if the world is going to the scenario SSP1 1.9, the near term, AR6 is different from AR5. AR5 divide the term or the range, the period of the time into two periods. But for AR6, they divide the term of the period of the time into three periods. That is near term, mid term, and long term. Give us more detail. Near term, that is 2021 and to 2040. Mid term, 2041 to 2060. And long term, 2081 to 100. So, for example, SSP1, let's say in the near term, that is very close because now we are in 2020. So very likely that temperature is going to 1.2 to 1.7. So that is the way that they try to look to the how possibility is going to happen in the future. Okay. Another thing that is about the climate change impact. Now we look to the impact of the agriculture and water management. Impact of the agriculture and water management because of increase of the atmospheric carbon dioxide. So that's why it's good for the boost crop growth. Part of that increased photosynthesis, part of that, but it also affect the climatic variables. We already know that I already talked about the pattern change, the amount change, the extreme event, temperature, rainfall, vapor prediction deficit. So here is the example that if temperature change in sufficient water and nutrient that is not available, increase may be reduced or reversed. So there is just like effect that is part of that sometimes that is not good. If you see that it's look good, but actually that is not. elevated carbon dioxide that is related to reduced protein and nitrogen in soybean and result a loss of quality. Yes. So part of this, you can look to the more in detail in the EPA, in the climate change impact. Another thing that is about the main linkage between climate change and water cycle that is showing about the climate change, global warming, they separate into long-term change and extreme events. Long-term change, just like a temperature rising up, I show you the figure, the graph, precipitation change that is showing. Extreme events come more often or not. You need to notice it, or you need to just like pay attention. You can pay attention easily, even just like in your country. More often about the flooding, more often about the drought, that is the typhoon that is in my country, the typhoon that is the North America, that is hurricane, more often or not. Water system, pay attention about the water, both quantity and quality that is change. Water quantity change, runoff, soil moisture, groundwater. I already show about the change of the surface runoff and water yield. And water quality, because of quantity depending related to the water quality, especially about the salinity in some country. Okay. And also about the crop production system and livestock production system impact the crop area and the crop yield. That is true. That is the linkage between the climate change and the water cycle. And then we're talking about the effect of climate change and observe possible impact on the water service. That is the index showing about increased atmospheric temperature, going to the reduction in water available, sea level rise, effect to salinization of coastal aquifer, increased evapotranspiration, going to effect to water availability reduction and salinization, and also intense extreme events, more frequent about flood, affect water quality, infrastructure, drought, affect water availability. So I think that many countries now just like have a lot of study about drought and flood area that is affect people, is damaged, just like a property and also just like hurt people as well. Impact of climate change on agriculture, this figure just show about some effect of global warming, increased frequent weather, lost biodiversity, and also just like about the increased incident of pests and vector. So that is also when we have the extreme even more, or we have just like about the change of those variables, is going to affect us, even just like in social, agriculture, community, or everything. That's why I told you at the beginning, now we are focusing on about the adaptation and mitigation that is part. Because for example, just for me now, I study only the impact. Show about the, okay, surface runoff higher, just like runoff lower, extreme event come often, drought event come often, and then finish with this. It's not going to answer the question or help people with this kind of the results. It's going to go and continue for the adaptation and mitigation. Okay, the scientists, engineering, okay, you already know it is going to happen. What you are going to help people to reduce the impact or the effect of that, what you're trying to do. Changing the type of the crop that is going to help or not, but don't forget to look about the price, the productivity, the market as well. Changing about the crop calendar is going to affect about the way of the social, about the way of the people or not. changing that is going to affect about water management, release water from the reservoir or from the dam or not. Is everything is like connected. So that's why adaptation comes just like very important right now. Okay. Here is the climate change on agricultural productivity. If you work in the agricultural field, you can see it and do you, this is quite a bit old, but I think the World Bank has like a new one as well. That is percentage change in yield between 2010 and 2050. You can see that which country that has just like a higher crop productivity and which country gets just like a decreased crop productivity. That is showing that. I hope that World Bank is have another report, recent report. Another thing that it impact that is about the change in agricultural production to climate change as well, showing global warming, agriculture impact each country as well. Quite similar that is less, showing less productivity and higher or more productivity. And also I'm speed up because come to the last one, that is climate smart irrigation. Because of in the title of the session today, the keyword climate change, the keyword about how to estimate that, the impact of climate change, and come to the concept of the climate smart agriculture and irrigation. So concept of the climate smart agriculture irrigation, climate smart practice and technologies, and also about the case study. I think that because most country that work with the concept of the climate smart agriculture, that is one part of the adaptation. It's one part that what you can do to prepare or to cope with the climate change. So for the climate smart irrigation or climate smart agriculture, what is it? Well, there the abbreviation of the climate smart agriculture, that is CSA. So what is the definition of the CSA? CSA, that is the way, that is the method, that is to try to transform, try to develop, try to adapt, try to get the new knowledge, new method for the new climate change, climate condition. So that's why agriculture, the sustainability increase productivity, try to enhance resilience, that is the name of the our course training, enhance the resilience or try to adaptation. Not only adapt, need to make the difference between adaptation and mitigation. Not only adapt, but you need to pay attention more to reduce or to remove greenhouse gas emission as well. That is the way. Otherwise, if you see the scenario, you can remember A1B1, or you can remember RCP1 until RCP5. If you don't do anything for greenhouse gas emission, it's going to go to just like the highest one, that is RCP5 or SSP5 scenario. That's why it should come together for the adaptation and for mitigation. Enhance and achievement. The achieve one, I highlight this. The achieve one, the goal of the CSA climate smart agriculture or irrigation, that is about national food security and development. So you need to make sure that about the security of food for people, that is the main one, the goal. So here is the CSA, you try to look to the way of sustainably increased productivity. Let's look to the strengthened resilience to climate change and variability, and also reduce agriculture contribution to climate change. Here is the goal of that. The goal that is to make sure that in your country or even as a country in your region or just like further, that is make sure that they are provided by the food, they have the food security. So for main part of the CSA. That's why they divided into main part, main section. The first one that is productivity. The second one that is the adaptation. And the last one that is the mitigation. It should come together, all of this. Productivity that you cannot avoid talking about increase. Agricultural productivity, you have the way that is try to adapt the type, adapt negative impact, the way that you do the agriculture that is no negative impact to the environment around that. The adaptation, that is how you try to reduce the exposure of farmers. Try to reduce the risk. Let's say that try to reduce the risk. But I know that is a bit difficult, but there are a lot of research today. Because of if you want to try to reduce the risk, try to adapt, it means that if it's not the lab scale, it's difficult to do the lab scale. If you want to do it in the just like to the people, to the farmers, it means that it also has a risk as well. If you want to change their life, the way of life that they used to produce this, they used to crop this. If you want to change it, you have to make sure that they earn the money, they earn the income that is equal to the same, right? That is the effect a lot for the adaptation way. So need to make sure that. Mitigation reduce the greenhouse gas mitigation. It means that if deforestation, that is about managed soil and other things, carbon sink, absorb carbon dioxide, and also about, so we have I didn't go in detail, I'm not going to in detail, but we have just like carbon credit, if you're familiar with the carbon credit. And we have also the carbon footprint, try to give people know about the way that is carbon dioxide that is produced in the atmosphere, something like that. It is the way of the mitigation. We have a class tomorrow, very interesting class about the greenhouse gas emission, especially about the agriculture reduction of the greenhouse gas emission for tomorrow. And also, we also have the practice of the climate smart agriculture, soil management, practice about the soil management, water management, crop production, livestock management, forestry, capture, fisher, energy management. So we have practice about this that all around the world try to work about the climate smart agriculture. I have the example and I will show you the website of this that you can see it easily. That is a sample of crop production contribute to climate smart agriculture. If we talk about the crop production, we need to talk about the breeding, a higher yield of crop variety, nutrient management, species selection that is very important, just like a drought tolerant, for example. Adaptation about the plant breeding, disease resistant, switching crop and mitigation. About how we are going to do about the crop production for soil and concern at the same time about the soil and water management. So this is the project in Vietnam, that is Mekong Delta, Vietnam means rice area. They have the objective to increase the adaptive capacity of rice production and to provide farmers and management agency objective. I will show you the website after this. And that is from the website that in relation between climate smart irrigation. You need to look, seems like a look, all the things that is smart way, carbon smart, water smart, yield smart, risk smart, and community smart. Try to get more information, knowledge, innovation thing that is help about health people to reduce the impact of the climate change. Here is the result of this research showing climate risk that is showing the way of, okay, so now you know which part of the region in the Mekong Delta here, which is the high risk, medium risk, low risk. The question is that, okay, we know, and what next? So now we know that it is risk map, salinity, intrusion risk. Okay, we know about this. What next? Now we know. It next is mean that you need to get just like more interest in the, maybe just like in the area that is high risk, and then give some part of that in the low risk, try to make the priority, which one that is should be concerned, and which one that is, okay, you need to help is, but maybe you can, they can wait, or maybe they have other thing to support first. So here is the result of the research, but what we are going to do with this result that is very important in the future. Another thing of that is about the example of the water management, that is innovation to reduce what? Reduce the crop water stress, improve capture, retention, rainfall, and try to make the, to get the irrigation water that is used, the water efficiency, something like that about the productivity. And try to make the adaptation, get the water management innovation to the rainfall capture, reducing, eliminate the risk, and also reduce water use. Mitigation, try to reduce the greenhouse gas. You can know that about the wet and dry crop for rice, that is try to reduce the methane. And the, yeah, wetting and drying cycle to use the water for rice. That is one way that is quite, I think that is quite famous, that is wetting and drying cycle. Try to reduce the methane. Here is the water management contribute to climate smart irrigation. That is try to reduce 30% reduction and 48% reduction. Let me move to the website a bit. I will try to show you about the this website that I think is very helpful. I like it a lot. That is show you a bit. Now you see the website or not? I hope that you see the website.
Yeah, we see it.
Okay, thank you. So this is the show you the website that is what is climate smart. That there are a lot of the people working about the climate smart agriculture. That is one group of people, okay, but there are a lot. And also they have the basic thing that you can learn. They also have about the, let me see about the, I like this one, about the project. About the project, many projects around the world, just like changing from local breeds to crossbred cattle, and also climate smart village, and also about Peru, developing sustainable cocoa value change, food tolerant rice variety in India and Bangladesh. So here is the website that you can see it. Just like, and give you information more about the climate, about the practice, about the climate smart agriculture, and about the, just like try to look to the real practice that people working it right now. We have just like a many case study that you can study more, and also you can adapt it in the in your country or in the region. Or maybe some part of your country working about it, or just like you can compare it about the result or about the method. Just like the here that I just told you practice in the soil management, crop production, water management, livestock, forestry, and energy management as well. So study more about this website that can give you more in idea and about the climate smart agriculture. I think I already put this website in the slide. If you are interested to continuing more, okay. here. Let me see the website. Oh, I will put it. I will put it in the chat box. I need to put it here. I will put it in the chat box. Just a second. That you don't have to search more. Just get it. Okay. Okay, and yeah, okay. And I think that we come to the end of the session, right? Let me see. It seems like, yes, we come to end of the session. Oh, I haven't finished talking a lot. So you have any question? Talking 3 hours is quite a long time and no one talking to me.
So if anyone have a question, please turn on your microphone and ask the camera.
If you want to see more, what is about, have any question, put it in the chat box, ask directly. No?
I have one, doctor.
Yes.
You said people should start adaptation with climate change.
Yes.
It is too late to recover, I mean, by reducing or even removing the emission of greenhouse gases.
Okay, go ahead.
I mean, during COVID-19 pandemic, we saw some satellite picture,
yes,
which show high reduction of greenhouse gases.
Okay.
So the second part of our question, how much time that we need to back to safe level if we do this strategies?
Okay, that is very interesting question, because of, I used to get that question as well, that is too late or not, right? That is the main part that is. I like to say like this, we can do better than doing nothing. That is the thing, okay? Because of, we already know that is about the greenhouse gas emission that is coming up, but we nowadays, we come up with the many innovation that is help us to reduce the greenhouse gas. And also because of climate change is put in the SDG, you know, it's right, sustainable development goals in SDG. So that is the part of most country know and try to reach of the goal of the SDG. And also we try, I answer that because of, I seems like not all the people, but most people we trying just like we have the COP26, as you know, that people try to brainstorming, try to make for each country, try to make a threshold how much the greenhouse gas we need to reduce. And they try to be proud that they make the, for Thailand, we can say that in part of transportation, we make the reach of the commitment that we gave it. So that is the way that is we try to help to reduce for each country and also for about the development innovation. And even now we get more in detail and try to put the course or about this topic for the students, try to concern about it. Is this too late or not? If we look back at the past, actually, if you can remember, I talk about AR4, I talk about SRE. They already started this at the beginning. I just like from 2000s, from 1919, something that is like in the history. But just like most people nowadays seem get to know more and seem concerned. I hope that, I think that. If you say that it's too late or not, no. I can, I will say that not too late. Not anything that is too late. No, this is not. And also we have just like people try to develop in the economic way that is interesting more people about the carbon credit that I talking about. If you are interested, it is quite interesting that you will get the benefit if your factory or if your business can reduce the greenhouse gas, when people get the benefit back, they will see more, just like, and concern more. That's the truth, right? That's the way. I don't know I answered the question or not, but just like, I get the point that is, that is too late or not. No, I think that is not too late. Okay.
And I think, the second part of my question.
Yes.
If we do the strategy of reducing or even removing the greenhouse gases emissions,
yes,
by using this model, I mean, how much time that we need to back to the safe levels?
How much time we need to back to the what?
To the safe levels of greenhouse emissions.
To the safe level, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. When we're talking about the climate change, or I didn't say about it, that is a very good question. We have the business as usual. We have the main part that is business as usual. Business as usual is mean that the part, the period that before we are developing the before the industrial developing era. So that one, there is no real definition how much greenhouse gas in the world is going to be back. But when we compare it, we usually compare it with the business of usual life. So each country have the business of usual life that is quite different. For example, just like you have to have the organization that is set up the business as usual. That's it. Before this, okay, that is, we don't do much. We don't have the effect about the climate change. That is not much about the industrial development. That is effect to about the climate change. So if you read paper or if you read the report, you will see about the business as usual. That's the way that they compare back to the level that is not affect less effect of climate change, not much effect to the people. So let's back look back to this word about the business as usual. Yes. Have another question? We still have time, 6 minutes, but we can have more time if you have more questions.
Okay, well, our old friend from Belize, Mr. Elder Kivell, he asked, maybe it's the same question for, because I also think about this question also. Mm-hmm. He asked about the model that you use, which one that you recommend for agriculture?
From all the models mentioned, which one would you recommend best for? Okay, let me ask a bit. I'm not sure. All the model model in the part of the estimation climate change on the model or about the practice of the agriculture or CSA, which model? Mr. Elder.
So you mean the AR6 is the best?
I'm not sure for the question is when you talk about the models, it mean that the scenarios or the mathematical models or about the practice of the agriculture, which model? Let's say it. If you talk about the scenarios, models or assumption, that is as my knowledge, I don't see specific scenario or the thing that is suitable for which sector. Usually people try to study and compare for each one, if you mean at that models. But if you talk about the model, just like about after doing downscaling and put to the model and then estimate the impact to the agriculture, if you mean about that model, crop what, that is one thing that you can use it and it's free. That is the thing that is free, that you can use, you can put the data from the GCM doing downscaling and put it in the crop what to study about the ETO and productivity as well. You can search it in the in the academic paper. Another thing that is aqua crop, but I'm not expert with the aqua crop. Dr. Chupan, aqua crop, is it freely or not?
It's free.
Oh, okay. So aqua crop is another model for the crop productivity. That is, you can study more and you can work more about the effect or about the impact after you put all the data from the scenario from the climate change into the model. And so if you talk about the practice, things that is about the climate smart agriculture, that is, if talk about the agriculture, it is difficult for me to say that it is the bad thing because of it depends on the characteristic of your country and land, and just like about the crop productivity. So just like for Thailand, we have a lot, study a lot about wet and dry cropping pattern, that is for rice, try to reduce the methane, but and also try to maintain about the productivity. So this is, if you mean about this model, that is about the way that you want to know about which one is the best one, I think it depends on the country and all characteristic. Mr. Elder, I answer your question or not? I try to think about what, which model that you are mentioned or which you are talking. I am not sure, so I answer or I'm not sure that it is I answer or not.
Or maybe he means about the GCM model, like website, CAN, ESM, or something.
we try
because it's a lot of model. I'm so confused that which one is the best one.
I say that. Which one that is good model or not, it depends on they compare it by looking at the historical data of the model and try to look compare to the historical data for observation. So that's why if you want to see that which model that is reliable or how different, you need to search more to look to the comparison of the people or researchers studying. And just like they are going to give you just like an idea that is, so which model work for which variable, just like which model gave you a more precipitation that is reliable compared to the historical data compared to another model. So that's why cannot say exactly which model, because of, don't forget that one model give you a lot of variables. So if you want to say that which one of the model that is good, which one that you say about the variable as well, right? That's his thing. Which model that we have? I don't know.
So we have 100 of model and also many scenarios. So if we want to compare all of model and all of scenarios, this means we have 1,000 of case study, right?
It is not like that. Because of before you are going to compare scenario, you're supposed to compare historical data first. That is the way. So that's why if you compare historical data of the model with the observation, you can say a bit about, okay, which one that is very close or similar to give the data that is very close to the observation. And then you can select only that model, compare scenario, you can do that. Or if you have the time and also if you want to know more how the different about the SSP each scenario, you can do it later as well. So, but first, try to look and compare to the historical data first, because model give you from 1980 for historical data. So you can compare it. If your area or if your basin has the observation data from the past.
Okay, so you recommend that we need to compare the historical data to the model first, and then we just select just only one model and compare between the scenarios.
If you can select only one, or you can do just like all the thing that is the same, because of, you know why? Because of if you set the model, or if you set up about the hydrological model, just like agriculture model, easily to put it, right? So you can compare all of that is okay as well. That is the thing that I already did. Compare the flight form for many model as well. You can do it. Yeah. But if you don't have time, if you are going to finish your master or other things and you need to rush, you can do it. Yeah. Have another question? Oh, this is 3 hours. Very good. Yeah. Usually I teach students around we have a break, right? So not totally 3 hours. If you don't have any question, if you have questions, first you can send an email to me. Send an email, or you can, which way? We don't have another way. So you have way now, just like send us an email, and then I will answer the question. And I have a test that I will, Dr. Chupan will put it in the classroom. It's not difficult. I just want to know more and get information from you guys, that is what your country do about the climate change and about the project, that is just like sharing information from each other. That is very useful.
Okay, Dr. Gebra, please can you email
okay address? Sure, I will share the email,
or maybe in the Google Classroom also.
UNC.th. Here is the email of the university. I hope everyone has the Google Classroom, because I check it. All of you guys just like inside the Google Classroom. Okay. Or please send your email in classroom. Oh, I send it here. That is okay. I will post it in the classroom as well in case. Okay. And very good to see you guys. So now. We done? We finished?
Any more questions?
Thank you.
More questions?
Nice presentations.
Pardon?
Thank you.
Pardon?
I would like to say thank for your time for these presentations.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. You are very welcome, because really lovely to share information for you guys. And I'm willing to answer or to get more information and get knowledge from you as well, if you have anything to share, okay? And don't forget for tomorrow, the another greenhouse gas reduction. That is very interesting, okay. Okay.
And just the outside question from the your lecture, I mean,
yes.
the exercise or our assignment, when we need to submit it.
Oh, actually, first we thought about what we are gonna do, Dr. Chupan. I'm not sure. Okay, let's do this around 2 or 3 days. This is gonna be okay, right? Because each session, the speaker need to check it and collect it to assess your understanding, right? So maybe 2 or 3 days, that okay for you guys?
Okay,
3 days.
Okay.
3 days. I try to make it.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay, right. I try to make it easier, because of at the beginning we said in 1 day, but I think that you have just like in the work to do as well. So yeah. In three days, it should be good. Yes.
Yes, I thank you. Session. Thank you.
Yeah. What else? What else? No, nothing. So, Dr. Chupan.
Okay.
Summarize.
So, today is a brief introduction about the climate change. But if you want to know more about the someone in this training course, if you want to study further in the master's degree or PhD, Dr. Gebra also teach in master and PhD in this department.
You're welcome.
So you can apply directly to this department. And now even our department teach in Thai, but if have some foreign student apply in this department, we can switch the lecture from Thai to English. So if you want to do the research more about the climate change or interesting it about the climate change, you can apply to Dr. Kevala.
or if you want to just like do a project in your work or something like that, and need to just like information or data or something or advice, I'm very welcome. So we just like we can share the information and knowledge together. Yes. Okay.
And for tomorrow, we have the program further about the mitigation of the climate, greenhouse gas. Tomorrow, the topic is reducing greenhouse gas emission from agricultural sector in order to improving and maintaining the resilience of climate change by Associate Professor Thamadi Suksarot. We will see you again at the same time, 9 to 12 o'clock in Bangkok time. So, please.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'll come tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you very much. And thank you for today.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Kevala. And see you tomorrow, everyone.
Yeah. See you.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.